morning. Welcome to Paksar Church. Today we are talking about why the world needs kindness. See, we live in a world where kindness is in short supply. It has become the forgotten virtue. For most people, kindness is not the first response. They ask, what is in it for me? But the Bible says in the book of Ephesians, be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other just as in Christ God forgive you. Kindness is rooted deeply in the character of God. We know what kindness is all about because we all have experienced it through the goodness of God. So when you talk about kindness, we are not just talking about mere politeness. We are talking about a quality that is representative of love, mercy, tenderness, and compassion. This is how God relates to us. You see, God treats you and me with a loving, merciful, compassionate kindness, even when we don't deserve it. That's why the Apostle Paul said in Romans chapter 8, but God showed his great love for us by sending Christ to die for us while we were still sinners. You see, that is the kind of kindness God wants us to show to other people. Kindness is not just feeling sorry for other people, but it is doing something for other people. It is the quality to feel the pain, the ability to feel the pain of others and be able to sit where they sit. It is love in action. So this morning, I want us to look at four aspects of kindness from Luke chapter 10, verse 25 to 37. It's a story Jesus told about the Good Samaritan. We are all familiar with this story. In this story, a man was attacked by robbers. They took everything from him and left him to die on the street. A couple of religious people passed by and they saw him lying there but did nothing to help him. Then a Samaritan man came along and he helped this man. So the first thing that we learn from this story is kindness is showing genuine concern for other people. Look at this verse. But a Samaritan who was traveling that way came upon the man, and when he saw him, his heart was filled with pity. In other words, when he saw this wounded man, his heart was moved with compassion and kindness. Can I ask you, do you ever feel that way when you see people in need? Does your heart move with pity and kindness? The interesting thing about this story is that Samaritan man had no reason to show kindness to this man, because the man lying on the ground was a Jew, and the Jews basically hated the Samaritans. But the Samaritan man showed concern for this man in spite of the racial and religious prejudice. See, Jesus told us to love our neighbors, but he also told us to love our enemies. Look at this verse. When Jesus saw the crowds, he had compassion on them because they were confused and helpless like sheep without a shepherd. Jesus was moved with compassion because he saw people lost without God. That should be a compelling reason for us to show kindness to everyone, because without Jesus Christ, people are lost. And it is our act of kindness that can lead people to the Lord. So our kindness must begin with a genuine concern for other people. Secondly, we can learn from this story that kindness is making meaningful connection. Our concern for people must move to action. Look at this verse. The Samaritan man went to him and bandaged his wounds, pouring on oil and wine. You see, kindness is not just feeling sorry for someone or just being sympathetic. It is doing something about it. It is getting involved. It is connecting with people. Today we live in a world of non-involvement. We say, mind your own business. Don't get involved. You know, she'll be all right, man. Look after yourself. We have become so self-centered that we don't really care about other people. We get up in the morning and we go to work. We sit in the train with our eyes and ears tuned to our iPad, iPod, or iPhone. We don't want to look at anyone. We don't want to talk to anyone. We do the same thing when we get on a lift, we looked at the numbers and no eye contacts at all. We come home from work, not much connection with people in the home either. Everyone goes to their rooms, watching TV or playing games. In fact, we text our kids when the dinner is ready. We come to church with the same attitude. We don't make the effort to get to know anybody. We call ourselves God's family, and we don't take the initiative to get to know each other. Friends, you and I are the face of Jesus Christ people need to see today. You and I are the voice of Jesus people need to hear today. Look at this verse from James. My friends, what good it is to say you have faith when you don't do anything to show that you really do have faith. Faith is an active word, my friends. Love is an active word. Our faith and love need to be seen by our action. Living with a heart of kindness means you make meaningful connection with people around you. Number three, what we learn from this story is that kindness is taking time to care for the people. Look at what the Samaritan did in this story. Then he put the man on his own donkey, took him to an inn and took care of him. He didn't say, oh, I'm so sorry this happened to you. I hope everything will be okay. No, he did everything possible to make sure that this man will be safe and he will be taken care of. The Samaritan man could have given all kinds of excuses not to help this man. He could have said, you know, I'm very busy. I work 6 days a week. I have a family to take care of. I am tired. I don't have any time to stop and help someone. He could have said, why should I help a person who is a racist? He criticizes me. He calls me names. He ignores me. He makes fun of me. Why should I help a person like that? He could have justified very easily not being involved, but he did. Why? Because he had a heart of kindness, and it is his kindness that moved him to care for this man. Look at this verse from 1 John chapter 3. This is how we know what love is. Jesus Christ laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for our brothers and sisters. You see, if anyone has material possession and sees a brother or sister in need but has no pity on them, how can the love of God be in that person? Dear children, let us not love with words or speech, but with action and in truth. When your heart is filled with kindness, you cannot be a selfish person. You don't think of yourself. You think of what you can do for other people. The fourth thing about kindness that we learn from this passage is kindness is willing to pay the cost. A kind person is willing to pay the price. Look at verse 35. The next day, he took out 2 silver coins and gave them to the innkeeper. Look after him, he said. And when I return, I will reimburse you for any extra expenses you may have. You know, 2 silver coins in those days worth a person's 2 days of wages. Why give that kind of money to help a stranger? Was he expecting something in return from this man? No. He probably would never see this man again. But he did it because of his love for his fellow human being. He did it because he knew that everything he owns came from the Lord in the first place. Let me ask you, do you help someone because you are expecting something in return from that person? Then you are doing it for the wrong motive. It is when you do it without expecting anything, that is the time God will reward you. So how do you know that you have a kind heart? Examine these 4 things that we talked about today. Do you show concern for other people? Do you make meaningful connection with people? Do you care for other people? Are you generous with your time, your money, and your energy when it comes to serving God? In a few moments, you know, we will be taking part in the communion. The communion table reminds us of God's kindness towards us. The Bible says Jesus was moved with compassion and kindness when he saw that people were lost. So he made the connection with us. He came to us. He became one among us. Then He paid the price for our sin by dying on that cross. But He rose from the dead to give us a brand new life, to give us eternal life. He took care of us. As we take part in this communion, let us remember the kindness, the compassion, and the love of our Lord Jesus Christ and the sacrifice He made to save us. Let us follow the example of Jesus Christ in our lives. This week, let's reach out to others in kindness, with concern and compassion, so they can get a taste of God's amazing love and amazing grace. Shall we pray? Father God, we thank You that You are the God of compassion and kindness. Thank You for showing Your kindness to us while we were still sinners. Thank You for sending Your Son Jesus Christ to reach out to us while we were lost. Thank You, Jesus, for everything You have done to save us, to forgive us, and to give us eternal life. Lord, we pray that You help us to show Your love and kindness to all the people around us. Help us to love others the same way You loved us. Help us to see others through Your eyes. Help us to see the value of every human being that You have created. Father, give us a heart of compassion to share the good news of salvation to everyone and to make disciples of all nations. We praise You and we thank You in Jesus' name. Amen.
It's good to be with you. And as we come to remember what Christ has done for us. And I want to read to you from God's Word from Luke chapter 22 today as Jesus celebrated the Last Supper with his disciples, his last words to them before he went to the cross. Let's read together what God's Word says to us about what Christ has done for us. When the hour came, Jesus and his apostles reclined at the table and he said to them, "I've eagerly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I tell you, I will not eat it again until it finds fulfillment in the kingdom of God." After taking the cup, he gave thanks and said, "Take this and divide it among you. For I tell you, I will not drink it again from the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes." Can't wait for that day when we eat and drink with Jesus. And he took bread, gave thanks and broke it, and he gave it to them saying, "This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took after the supper, he took the cup saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you." Jesus poured out his blood for you, my friend. He poured it out that we might have forgiveness, we might have hope, we might have new life, we might be made into new people, being made more and more like Christ. He gave all this for us because God so loved us, because Christ so loved you. Isn't that incredible? That he would die for you even before you were born, even before you existed, but you were in his mind's eye before the beginning of creation. He thought of you and chose to die for you. What an incredible Savior we have. Let's remember what Christ has done for us. Let's come and remember, let's eat the bread and drink this juice in remembrance of what Christ has done for us. Let's pray. Lord, we are so incredibly thankful for what you've given for us. Father, you gave your only Son. And Lord Jesus, you gave your life that we might have life and have it to the full, that we might have forgiveness and hope, that we might be made into new people, that we might know that we are not alone, that you walk with us. Lord, we give you glory, honor, and praise today. We ask your forgiveness for any sins we've committed, any wrongs we've done. And we thank you for the incredible hope we have in you. In the mighty name of Jesus, amen. Thank you so much and God bless you.
It was wonderful to have you join us today. We hope that today's message and time of worship has touched your heart. If you're free next Sunday, we'd love to have you join us here in person. Otherwise, all our services are always available on our YouTube channel. Additionally, if you'd like to gain more insight from God's Word, check out our church podcast available to download on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, or via our church app, which you can download from our church website. Take care, and we'll see you next week.